Welcome, sir. Two eminent speakers who need no introduction. They'll be debating for and against the use of definitive airway for laparoscopic surgeries. So one would say that we should be using supraglottic airway devices, and one probably we need to do it under intubation. We'll see what's in store and what we can take home as message. Over to you, sir.
Thank you for the introduction. So Dr. Krishna has told about the topic. Definitive airway for laparoscopic surgeries. I am for the definitive airway. And is there any doubt what it is? It is the endotracheal tube. And that's me. As a preamble, I thank the organizers for thinking about me by putting my name here. That's where I come from. I come from Amala Medical College, Thrissur, about 2 hours from here. And in the context of this debate, thank you, Dr. Suvarna, for being bold enough to contest the time and tested endotracheal tube. Disclosures to make, I haven't spoken to Dr. Krishna, Dr. Suvarna about this topic, so I haven't seen her slides. I don't know what she's going to tell about it. And I'm not against SADs, supraglottic airway devices in general. But in this context, yes. My assumptions on how she is going to tackle it is she's going to do a Google search or some search, and she's going to get a lot of articles to defend her. We'll come to that. So I start off with the Hippocrates' oath. First, do no harm. We all know, even if you don't do any good, please don't do any harm. So why is this crusade against endotracheal tubes? Is it just because it's the gold standard and you want to do it differently? Is it just to prove a point? Is it just in the hope of emulating things that happen in the West? Why it is happening in the West, we'll come to that. Truly, is there any real evidence out there to substantiate that SADs are better, and not as equal as, better than endotracheal tubes for laparoscopic surgeries? Endotracheal intubation. Are we really scared of it? Aren't we the masters of this art? Are we just being lazy in the sense that we can probably spare maybe 5 minutes or something like that if you think so? Are we worried about the cost? We shouldn't be, because endotracheal tube costs only around 250 or something like that. An LMA, which is supposed to be disposable, will cost 700 rupees plus. Are we worried about those rare or mild side effects with an endotracheal tube? I'll come to that. So let's compare the side effects and the complications. Side effects of an endotracheal tube: sore throat, injuries, etc. Are there really such big issues to compromise on safety? If so, there are advocates of central neuroaxial blocks for laparoscopic surgeries. There is no airway issue there. Why doesn't the majority support them? So that's how my expression is when I tell about that. But there are people who do it. Now, side effects of not having an endotracheal tube. We all know improper ventilation, basal atelectasis. There was a talk in the morning about how much of FRC decreases and vital capacity decreases and things like that and all. Aspiration, not able to do recruitment maneuvers, no PEEP can be offered. And suppose the surgery is not straightforward. Every time, can you predict that the surgery is going to be straightforward? I doubt it. National Anesthesia Project, probably the biggest projects in those particular fields. NAP4 was on airway issues, and in that, it's written, there is one skill above all else that an anesthetist is expected to exhibit, and that is to maintain the airway impeccably. The most compelling educational effort for the anesthesia community should be to reduce the frequency and severity of complications related to managing the airway. So we should manage the airway impeccably. We shouldn't be taking a chance. Again, NAP4, 50% of the airway-related deaths in anesthesia were due to aspiration, and they far outweighed the much-feared cannot intubate, cannot ventilate scenario. Okay, so we are so scared about that. We get all the algorithms, but aspiration, is something that could have been prevented has happened and caused more deaths. Risk factors as per NAP4, upper GI surgery, laparoscopy, lithotomy, cholecystectomies have all been causes. Of the serious complications, about 5% were SAD related. Do we want that? And recommendation as per that on page 61 is once placed, a tracheal tube offers the highest protection against aspiration. Isn't there a chance of a bias? If there is somebody who does a supraglottic, puts a supraglottic airway for a laparoscopic case, in their mind they have the doubt that whether this patient might aspirate. And if something happens, won't it be underreported? I think so. All the comparative studies mention proper selection of patients. Why? If it is so safe, why do you have to properly select the patient? So the signal out there for everyone out here is evidence-based. It is maybe orange, but not yet green for SADs. So the signal is not green. The green signal has been there, is there, and will be there for endotracheal tubes. Think about the ifs for a supraglottic airway device. Suppose you're putting one. If not obese, if no airway issues, if not expecting any regurgitation, how many of you ask for a reflex history every time? If not pregnant, if not an appendicectomy, because appendicectomies supposedly do cause dysmotilities, and actually you are supposed to do a rapid sequence induction if you're giving a GA. So if there are so many ifs to be ruled out, why take a chance? My concerns, the surgeon might be the junior most, might be the person who takes the maximum amount of time, I don't know. The position, they'll start off with minimal Trendelenburg. Later on, probably the head will be on your lap. The length of the surgery, you can never assume the length of the surgery. The patient, you don't know what problems the patient has. And when the patient is going to have hypotension, you are bothered about the airway or the hypotension. At least if the airway is secure, you can bother about the other things. The intra-abdominal pressures, the surgeons will always start with a low pressure, but then you know how it goes up. And one serious complication should not leave a stain in my mind forever, that I was the root cause of it. Did you all read the fine print of this brochure? The topic is definitive airways for laparoscopic surgeries. It was not a quick look laparoscopy, but laparoscopic surgery. So even more important. Now, articles, I haven't taken up any case reports because there are humpty number of case reports. Sorry about that yellow coloration, but in my computer, it was actually much more clear. I'll read it out to you. This was the one that came in the critical care journal in 2011, I think. Yeah. The use of a laryngeal mask airway in laparoscopic surgery remains controversial due to the increased risk of aspiration and difficulties encountered when trying to maintain effective gas transfer. Again, another article, World Journal of Gastrointestinal Surgery. The use of LMA in laparoscopy is controversial based on a concern that about increased risk of regurgitation and pulmonary aspiration. So the ability of these devices to provide optimal ventilation during laparoscopic procedures has also been questioned. Up to date, to January 2023, it is actually for anesthesia for laparoscopic and abdominal robotic surgeries in adults. And they have written, choice of anesthesia device, we place an endotracheal tube for airway management for laparoscopy. And the reason they have written, the use of SGAs for laparoscopy is controversial. These devices do not fully protect against aspiration of stomach contents and are ordinarily used with low peak airway pressures. Very clear. Up to date, 2023. So why does the Western literature, most of the Western literature is where it all started, and then there are some Indian literatures which follow it. It's because recovery staff remove LMAs, at least in the UK, but not endotracheal tubes. So once I do a case, if you have so many cases, I can take the patient with an LMA to the recovery room, come back and start the next. sorry about that. Come back and start the next case. And there is a, probably I can save some time. So that might be the reason why they were not using, or they are very much pro LMAs. It's the same team usually. It's the same anesthetist and the same surgeon. Every day we tend to do the same list. Okay, so it's much more easier because you know the surgeon. If it is maybe a quick laparoscopy, maybe somebody or the surgeon communicates with you very well. He says that this might be, I might have a problem here. So it's much more safer doing it with one person because both of you know each other. But here, are you always sure about that? What about medico-legally? Have you thought about it? If you have a problem, then what is the opposite advocate? What is he going to bring up? All the evidence out there will mention gold standard is ETT. It is only as good as, it can be compared to, it could be used. You need proper patient selection. So just imagine your state if you are standing in the court. That will be how I'll be. And my experience in my 25 years plus of anesthesia, I don't remember having a single case which compelled me to do the case under LMA. Though many a times I've seen it happening in adjacent theaters, and I've always wondered why such heroics. It's like trying to change the three-point seatbelt. The seatbelt was actually introduced by Nils Bohlin for the World War cars, and they actually gave off that patent free, thanks to World War. And it has been in use since 1959, and nobody dared change it till now because it is safe. So the conclusion is, substitutes claiming to be as good as would keep on coming till the nth generation, but none of them till now have the safety profile history of our time-tested endotracheal tube. Once again, primum non nocere, that is, please do no harm. Just tube it, these cases, and the tool of the trade is our laryngoscope. Vote for me. On the side, I think endotracheal tube for this case should win the medal. And on behalf of the endotracheal tube, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Matters under dispute will not be subjected to elections. So that's why probably we are also sitting here. I request the next lawyer, Dr. Suvarna, the defense counsel, to speak in defense of what she is defending. Over to you, madam.
Good evening to all. Dr. Joe, you made my job very tough. In the beginning itself, I say when Dr. Srijit gave me this topic, I asked, why you are putting me into this trouble? How will I vote for supraglottic airway? At the disclosure, I have no financial gain or no conflict of interest to support supraglottic airways. It has been almost 40 years since Archie Brain introduced the great LMA classic into our armamentarium. That was the greatest development in the anesthesia for generations. And it has got rapid and worldwide acceptance quite early itself. In early 90s itself, more than 50% of surgeries were done under LMA, where an endotracheal tube would have been used formerly. And laparoscopic surgeries are on the rise for so many advantages like reduced postoperative morbidity and shortened hospital stay. I agree with Dr. Joe that maintaining the patent airway is our primary responsibility and endotracheal intubation is the gold standard in airway management. No doubt about it. I always teach my students about this only and I always use endotracheal tube only in laparoscopic surgery. But for this talk, I have to say something. So there is a paradigm shift in the airway management recently from endotracheal tube to supraglottic airways. And supraglottic airways are considered as an attractive choice if there are no contraindication. So there are endless debates like this. The safety and efficacy of supraglottic airway device in laparoscopy is always disputed. Many, I know majority are reluctant to use it in laparoscopy, especially if it is a prolonged surgery or head-on position or with a positive pressure ventilation. So why such a fear with a supraglottic airway device? And I searched, as Joe said, I searched the literature. Is there any evidence supporting the use of supraglottic? So what are the concerns when you say no to supraglottic airway device? The two main concerns are the regurgitation and aspiration if you use a supraglottic airway, and the insufficient ventilation in the face of a, in the place of a pneumoperitoneum and increased intra-abdominal pressure. So let us see why there is regurgitation during laparoscopy. It is mainly due to the iatrogenic pneumoperitoneum causing increased intra-abdominal pressure. Isn't the risk of regurgitation in laparoscopy overestimated? Because literature shows the increased intra-abdominal pressure of pneumoperitoneum itself will induce an adaptive response in the lower esophageal sphincter, which maintains the pressure gradient across the gastroesophageal junction. So the actually the risk of regurgitation is reduced when there is an increased pneumoperitoneum. And the head-down tilt in pelvic laparoscopy actually protects against aspiration. And another worry is the gastric insufflation from an insufficient seal caused by your supraglottic airway device. That is the most cited contraindication to use a supraglottic airway in laparoscopic surgery. But remember, the second generation and newer supraglottic airway devices have come up with several advancements in design. The gastric drain tube actually clearly separates the alimentary and respiratory tracts. So they improved the safety profile. It allows higher oropharyngeal leak pressure, so better protection against regurgitation and more successful positive pressure ventilation. Actually, this oropharyngeal leak pressure, it defines the feasibility of positive pressure ventilation and airway protection with a supraglottic airway device. With the ProSeal and Supreme LMA, the wider drain tube actually form a better esophageal seal. And the eye gel, because it is made of thermoplastic elastomer, it provides good position stability. There are n number of literature supporting supraglottic airway device in laparoscopy. This large study, retrospective study, analyzing the risk of aspiration with LMA centricular tube in 65,712 procedures with ventilation. LMA was used in 35,630 and ETT was in 30,082. Of this, only 2.4 was only laparoscopy. It was a general study. There were 3 cases of pulmonary aspiration with LMA and 7 with endotracheal tube and no cases of aspiration with laparoscopy. So see what literature says. So they projected as the major risk factor as the unplanned surgery. So it is the seal and correct positioning that determines the gastric insufflation with the supraglottic airway. So there are n number of literature supporting LMAs. Even classic LMA, there were only 3% of gastric insufflation. And several literature says the regurgitation is extremely low during laparoscopy with LMA, and it is more safe in other laparoscopic surgeries. When the intragastric pressure between endotracheal tube and supraglottic were compared in laparoscopic hepatectomy, remember laparoscopic hepatectomy is major abdominal surgery, the intragastric pressure was continuously monitored intraoperatively. They found that intragastric pressure did not show any difference between the two, and the pH of the supraglottic airway tip measured post-surgery was never less than 4. That means there was no regurgitation. So they conclude that there was no further increase in intragastric pressure with the supraglottic airway device, even in prolonged abdominal surgery, laparoscopic surgery, like laparoscopic hepatectomy. And there are many case reports and other reports of aspirations with the supraglottic devices. And the reasons of aspiration reported are, one is malpositioning, other is gastric insufflation from air leak from the supraglottic airway, and unfamiliarity with device and inappropriate patient selection. And the risk of aspiration is more in unfasted patient and in patients with bowel obstruction. So A properly positioned second generation supralaparoscopic airway device actually protects against regurgitation and aspiration for no doubt. What about the second concern, insufficient ventilation with the supraglottic airway? Actually, you all know that ventilation in laparoscopy is affected because of the physiological effect of pneumoperitoneum. Because there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, diaphragmatic excursion is going to be impaired, airway pressure and resistance is going to increase. Ultimately, airway compliance will decrease. So you have to modify your ventilation strategy. If you are using a supraglottic airway device, the peak inspiratory pressure should not exceed oropharyngeal leak pressure. There is this recent systematic review and meta-analysis compared the supraglottic airway and endotracheal tube for laparoscopic surgery, and they found no change in the oropharyngeal leak pressure or desaturation events with the supraglottic airway device, suggesting effective ventilation. Rather, laryngospasm, cough, dysphagia, sore throat, all the postoperative airway morbidities were more in the endotracheal tube group. So there are again so many literature supporting that LMAs, I mean supraglottic airways in laparoscopy provide adequate ventilation. The Dr. Joe has cited a fourth national audit project. I think he hasn't read it completely. There are 1 in 22,000 adverse events during anesthesia and mortality of 1 in 180,000 in the report. Of this, aspiration occurred in 23 cases during anesthesia, of which LMA was responsible for 13, IGL was 1, and ETT was 8, and no airway was in one patient. Do you think any major difference? No. What about the outcome? Of course, the airway morbidity is reduced with supraglottic airway device for no doubt. And another important point which you may not be aware of, the intra-cuff pressure of endotracheal tube shows significant increase during laparoscopy in the intraoperative period, which caused the postoperative airway morbidity like sore throat, hoarseness, dysphagia. All the airway morbidity are due to the increase in intra-cuff pressure. Whereas if you use a supraglottic airway device, there is no laryngospasm, sore throat, dysphagia. All the airway morbidities are reduced, and that can facilitate earlier discharge. So there are many other advantages, like intubation stress is avoided. You all know that. And there is less respiratory complications in a patient with other respiratory comorbidities. In this randomized trial, the second generation LMA was used for laparoscopic liver donor nephrectomy. This is a major complicated surgery, you know. The PSCO2 at 2 hours were equally effective between the two groups, between ETT and SAD, and there was no cases of pulmonary aspiration. So they also concluded that second generation LMA is equally efficient during liver donor hepatectomy during laparoscopy. So success depends on the selection of the patient and device, limiting the pneumoperitoneum in position. So the key to successful use is insertion by experienced use and correct positioning. Now, as Joe suggested, why go for GA? Why not segmental spinal? Anesthesia in patients with multiple comorbidities are always challenging because GA poses so many postoperative respiratory complications, and the conventional spinal cause adverse cardiocirculatory effect. Whereas a segmental spinal will limit your anesthesia to the desired levels, will offer better respiratory outcome. There are, again, n number of studies showing feasibility of segmental thoracic spinal for laparoscopic surgeries and other laparoscopic surgeries. Even compared with a conventional lumbar, it offers better hemodynamic stability and shorter sensory motor blockade. I know you all are worried about the neurological injury when you put a spinal at a thoracic level. But the MRI studies and several studies made sure that the posterior dural space is wide at the thoracic level. And with your sitting or lateral position, the spinal cord moves further anteriorly, and the acute angle of needle entry offers further advantage. And with the real-time ultrasound guidance, it offers safety in thoracic spinal. So there are so many advantages for segmental spinal, like no postoperative airway morbidity, greater hemodynamic stability, And it, of course, it is advantageous in patients with the comorbidities like severe COPD and all. And it reduced the unplanned ICU admissions. This very recent, in the 2023, the systematic review and meta-analysis defined the role of thoracic spinal in this. They have concluded that thoracic spinal is a safe, feasible, effective alternative anesthetic technique in patients with where GA pose a risk. And it is beneficial in elderly and frail where high perioperative risk from GA is there and ideal for daycare surgeries. Isn't ability to provide a safe and adequate anesthesia without an instrument in airway, isn't it a relief to both patient and anesthesiologist? Don't you think so? To summarize, supraglottic airways can be a safe alternative to endotracheal tube in laparoscopy, but the selection of the patient and the device is important, and the proper positioning is the key to your success. So choice between endotracheal and supraglottic device in laparoscopy is always disputed. Remember, there is never a single right way to anesthetize a patient. A properly positioned second generation supraglottic airway devices is safe in laparoscopy and disadvantages in selected patients. And segmental thoracic spinal can be a feasible alternative. Always do an individual risk benefit analysis in every case. And as Joe said, primum non nocere. First of all, do no harm. I also vote for endotracheal tube only. Thank you.
Madam, you seem to be suggesting another topic for debate, general anesthesia versus segmental anesthesia or regional anesthesia. Right, you have anything to counter or rebut? Majority of them are postgraduates, so I think the point...
I should counter, isn't it? Well done, Dr. Suvarna. Very difficult topic for her, actually. I was lucky that I was offered the best part. To counter, there was one study, 65,000 or something like that. Don't get carried away with the number. Only 2.4 or 2.5% were laparoscopies. One. Two. NAP study. She did say that I didn't read it. I read it on the context of laparoscopic surgeries. This debate is definitive airway for laparoscopic surgeries. It is not LMA versus ETT. Okay. So that what that was telling was, LMEs in general were found to have lesser complications, obviously, because those cases will be much more milder. Okay, ETTs will be the high-risk cases. So that is that. One more thing was there in my mind, which I forgot, but actually very well done, Dr. Suvarna.
Yeah, madam, you want to rebut any of his points? No.
I also teach all my postgraduate to do endotracheal tube only. And just for do this presentation, my postgraduates might remember, last week I put one eye gel for a pediatric diagnostic laparoscopy. Otherwise, I also use endotracheal tube only because that is a gold standard. As postgraduate, you should say endotracheal definitive airway only for the exam.
Yeah, they have clarified the things very clearly. Okay, so he had a benefit of being on the side of the standard of care, which still remains the endotracheal intubation for laparoscopic surgeries. If you think that there are advantages of supraglottic airway devices, you need to be very selective, very judicious. That's where your human intelligence factor comes in the operating room, taking advantage over artificial intelligence. And if there is a problem, you will need to justify why you chose a supraglottic airway device over endotracheal tube. So you need to be cautious. You need to have certainly definitive indications if you are trying to go for supraglottic airway device until we get better devices, better evidences, and better proof in favor of supraglottic airway devices. Is that acceptable by both of you? Yes? You want to add anything, madam? Very well done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, doctors. I